I can't believe I attempted this. In today's video, we survived 100 days in the Betweenlands, a brand new dimension with tons of features. A couple goals for this video is to slay the Sludge Menace, create a functioning airship, and kill off a Tar Beast without getting infected. Can we survive 100 days in this dimension? Watch till the end to find out. Also, we've recently hit 40k subscribers, which is an insane milestone. We're aiming for 50k next, so make sure to join the Before 50k club while you still can. Finally, make sure to like the video for the YouTube algorithm. Let's get straight into it. Day 1. Our journey in this new world begins with going through this strange green portal, never to see the overworld again. On the other side, at first, it didn't seem like that anything changed, but the one thing that did change was the dimension that we were in. And let me show you exactly what this new dimension looks like. It was very swamp-like. I saw a couple mushrooms that were fluorescent blue, but I'm not sure. I didn't exactly know what they were for, so I just focused on my surroundings. I wanted to get to know a little bit about the place I was in. Luckily, there was a lot of forestry, so I don't think we're going to be running out of wood anytime soon. Not to mention, we can always just use the portal room, which I don't think it should matter. I hope it doesn't matter. I decided to grab some dirt, then I tried breaking one of the blue mushrooms, but nothing actually derived from it, so it was a little bit of a waste of time. There were miniature mushrooms around the main mushroom, and these mushrooms were actually one of the main food sources that lasted us during the first maybe even 60 days. Right afterwards, I decided to break some wood with my bare hands. Luckily, unlike the abyss, I can actually break wood with my bare hands. So that was a bit of a plus. After getting wood from that tree, I then move on to the next tree. This tree had a little bit of a different bark to it and I wanted to check it out. But right when I was about to break it, there was this little critter that I caught on the side of my eye. I'm still, to this day, unsure as to what it exactly was. It didn't take us very long to realize it was not a harmful mob. After breaking a little bit of the tree bark, I then noticed that I got sap. The reason as to why this is so important is because if you take a look above our hunger bar, you'll notice that there's a new bar that's slowly taking its way down. And one of the most effective ways of keeping this up would be through sap, so we got a little bit of that. I did a little bit of exploring. In case we missed anything at spawn that I really didn't want to miss, there are some crucial things that we can find within the world, and I was really hoping to find some of these, but there wasn't that much luck. I decided to just deal with it, so I went to go mine some more wood, because obviously that's very important. I created a crafting table and started making some basic tools, an axe and a pickaxe for starters. I think that's a good start for any 100 Day series, if I do say so myself. As I've already mentioned, you can find tons of stuff and gear just throughout the world, so I wanted to explore it a bit and the new biomes that the game actually added for us. Days 2 to 5. During this process of exploration, I found a bit of a branch that kind of looked like an upside down stalactite at the time, and that's kind of what I thought it was. I don't know why in my head I didn't think that it was just a branch, but you know, it looked cool, so I decided to mine it, and I didn't really get much from it, but it was still pretty cool, so this made the cut. On our journey to either finding a dungeon or a really nice place to live, we also decided to check out the swampy waters. Honestly, when looking into the waters, I expected some gruesome looking fish. What I wasn't expecting was two species of fish fighting it out to the death right in front of my very eyes. The first creature, having some pretty sharp fangs, it didn't really emit any sort of light, but the second one kind of seemed like an anglerfish. The thing had a little bulb on the tip of its head, and you were able to see it pretty clearly. I knew for a fact I did not want any involvement with this whatsoever. And right when I make that decision to keep my distance, the angler-looking fish decides to jump at me and try biting my hand off. Like, why, man? I was literally avoiding you two. The whole point of me watching from a distance is to avoid going into the fight. It was a fair 1v1. I did not know why it had to jump out at me like that. It was very uncalled for, but eventually I did manage to make it to a safe spot. I really didn't want to see who was going to be the winner of that because I didn't want it to jump out again and maybe even poison me because the water definitely looked poisoned. We decided to move on. We just didn't want to deal with any of that, and it's pretty clear why. I also come to the realization that I have the mushrooms that I got from before, and I wanted a whole bunch of them, but there's a little bit of a catch with this mod pack. You're not able to just eat one thing. You have to eat a variety amount of things. Eventually, if you just eat one thing, you will get tired of it, and after you get tired of it, it will lose all value, which means just by eating it, you are not going to get any hunger back, and that was a problem. Days 6 to 10. We kept traveling all the way until we reached a little bit of an ocean biome. It was kind of interesting because in the far distance, we can see some miniature islands, but they were of abnormal height levels. Kinda weird if you ask me. But what I did end up noticing is that there was a little bit of a figure over the water. I really wanted to check it out. The problem with getting to it is I had to swim with normal Minecraft mechanics. This mod pack is a 1.12.2 mod pack, and swimming was adding in 1.14 during the aquatic update, so this kind of took a while. So, there's a little bit of an issue. By the time we got there, the figure disappeared. I don't know why. I really don't. It's whatever, we were bound to find some more later on down the road, so we just kept moving forward through the different biomes that we found. An interesting thing is, we found this gigantic root. On top of the gigantic root, there was a bit of a lengthy lily pad, as any sane adventurer would do. I decided to punch it till it falls, to see if it actually dropped something. Nope, I don't even know why I was... No, nothing was dropped. Days 11 to 15. So, a bit of a fun fact. There are side effects to eating these blue mushrooms. And that's becoming a druggie. By the way, YouTube, I don't support drugs. This is just part of the mod pack. Please don't demonetize me. Kids, don't do drugs. But besides the kind of annoying nausea effect, it did give us night vision. So when it is really, really dark outside, I will be able to see. And yes, it does become dark, even though there's no day and night differentiation. On my way to the route that I was actually standing on, I went to look back on my path and I noticed that one of the alligator-like creatures decided to hop onto one of the paths. They were just vibing there. Honestly, good on him. He seems to be enjoying life. The thing I mentioned earlier, the fact that there's no day and night differentiation, there are, however, events that occur within the world. At this moment, I decide to look up and I saw the rift. The reason that there's a rift here is because this dimension only exists as a product. The product of the nether and the end dimensions being created, and it's kind of like a dimension in between. That's exactly why it's called the Betweenlands in the first place, and it makes sense. We finally found ourselves at one of the places I wanted to explore. Now these places have crucial items that could help us seriously progress in the game a lot more than I could have ever imagined. Though I didn't know exactly too much about the items that we can obtain from here and what we can do with them, I did know that they were very useful, especially for endgame. So obviously, your boy tried tackling this one head first. It's just a tower, how bad can it be, right? What I did notice was on the pathway up there, these little pillars. On top of the pillars were the figures that we saw above the lake, the initial time, right before it, you know, disappeared and completely went somewhere else. I had no clue what these were for. Honestly, I thought they were just decoration. They might have been, I might be wrong, so if you guys can correct me in the comment section below, feel free to do so. We went up the staircase and first initial thoughts were just like, okay, there's probably like a couple zombies or something in here, right? Nope, there were these creepy looking scorpions that were super hard to hit, and what made things even worse is that I was not armored up at all. I had the bare minimum wooden gear of that dimension. We legit didn't even have stone tools yet, so I was not prepared for this whatsoever. But you know what? Your boy didn't care, okay? We were still trying to storm this tower. They had items I wanted, so your boy was getting in, one way or another. But right when I built up the confidence to actually go inside of the tower, the scorpion leaped out of the tower to try chasing me. And so I kind of booked it because I learned from the abyss, right? We survived 100 days in the abyss already. I learned that some of these mobs can one or two shot you. I was not going to take that chance. So I booked it to the side of the tower and started Bed Wars bridging upwards. There was no way I was going to die to some lousy scorpion. Inside of the tower, it was a little bit tricky, but I did manage to in fact kill a few of them. But one of the most important things from each layer is the pots. These are kind of styled like Legend of Zelda pots where if you break them, you get something in return. Now, instead of getting rupees, you kind of get some materials that are helpful for mid-game. Did I mention there's also a slight chance that a mini scorpion can come out of these pots when breaking them alongside the loot? Yeah, they have an even smaller hitbox, like silverfish, you could say. Now, I kid you not, within the tower, it started getting a lot darker, but that's because there was an event going on where the entire place stopped illuminating. That's a thing. I told you, there's no day and night cycle, but there's one of the events that basically just the entire dimension is unilluminated and we don't have torches. Not to mention the torch crafting recipe doesn't actually work here because when you place down a torch, it kind of unlights itself. It's very strange. So I decided to head back and leave the tower in itself. I definitely didn't want to stay a battle tower when it's pitch dark. But during this duration, I also found out that I can actually place the glow berries and they're luminescent. So they actually glow. They could work as somewhat of a type of torch, I guess, kind of. Sheesh, talk about playing with your food. Day 16 to 20. This duration of time was not a lot different from the past durations of time, except for the fact that we encountered a new biome. We were still looking around a bit, either looking for more structures or easier structures to loot than the one we've already found, and also looking for a nice place to live. But in that mist, we also found a little bit of a thing I like to call the swamp wastelands. Now, this land is very flat, but it's also very marshy, and there's a lot of mud that, you know, your boots get stuck on or your feet get stuck on, and so you're kind of sinking into your inevitable doom. Along with this, there are these things called shallow breath, which is literally air trying to kill you. Like, bruh, I didn't know I had to fight the elements in this mod pack. Like, a little bit of a random thing, before I realized just how annoying this biome was, I was, however, initially starting to think that this place wouldn't be a bad place for a base at all because of the fact that it was flat and there was a lot of space to work with. I guess I kind of just threw the mobs portion aside, and besides that, it was a pretty nice place. I found a tree and decided to hollow it out a bit, but then kind of changed my mind after making it. A very counterproductive thing. Oh, yeah, they're also demon bats. They're bats with glowy eyes, kind of, and they're very aggressive. So it's those things and shallow breaths that roam the lands here. They kind of run the place, and I didn't really want to meet them. We waited there for quite some time. This is because I wanted to wait until the darkness left. I was waiting for the event to finish, essentially. It wasn't going to take too long because then the next event would hit, and that's kind of how it works in this dimension. So I was just waiting there chilling looking at crafting recipes and my dark surroundings. After a while, it was still super dark, so I decided to move a little bit. I wanted to check out the area. I was getting a little impatient, and also I was wasting a bunch of time. So what I decided to do was eat up the glowberries. Wait, no, not the glowberries. That was the last video. The mushrooms. They give us a little bit of night vision, and I somewhat utilized that to see my surroundings. I wasn't sure what I was looking for, to be completely honest with you, from this biome, but I was avoiding everything at all costs. Oh, right, and also there are fireflies in this dimension. Also, look, it's a pink thing in the sky. I don't know, just some random stuff that I thought would be notable. Days 21 to 30. Alas, the darkness was gone. Now, an event that happened was the little bit of a rift that you can see here. This is very common in this dimension. There's sometimes rifts above us, on the side. In this situation, it was on the side, which I didn't really mind. A little bit later, despite us having the ability of sight once again, I ended up angering a shallow breath, so we were getting attacked by air. Definitely not a fun experience, especially when it poisons you. So I just honestly booked it. I used as many blocks as I possibly could to just build my way out of that situation. Eventually, we do in fact get to a safe spot, and I start eating some more of those glowing mushrooms. To heal up our health, of course, not because I have an addiction to the glowing berries or anything, right? Now, not only does this happen once, but it happens twice. We get attacked by shallow breath twice. And this is honestly somewhat my fault. I wanted to check out some of the structures, and I saw a chest in the middle of one of them. And, you know, lo and behold, there's a shallow breath protecting it. What I didn't know at the time was that there was a shallow breath spawner that was actually right next to it. And I didn't know how that exactly functioned at that time, so kind of an L on my part as well. Now, I kid you not, that shallow breath literally brought us down to half a heart. There was no time to waste, and I quickly built out of there as well, because they're a lot slower than us. I didn't stop until I left that biome. I went back to one of the more safer biomes, the one with a little bit of a lake. Obviously, there are piranhas, but this was much safer than getting attacked by air. I started eating some of the glow shrooms to recover some of my health, but I think at this time, I was kind of getting used to it, and that was a problem. That means the effect on my hunger that the berries had became less and less. We had to find a new food source, but on the bright side, we did find the cobblestone equivalent in this dimension. So we were able to now make stone tools, and we honestly mined out quite a few of this stuff. What can I say? We were gonna need a lot of it. After getting that suffice amount, I then went on to looking around a little bit more just in the area. I didn't want to go too much further. I wanted to make a house somewhat near here. It was somewhat safe, and I was pretty okay with this biome. Days 31 to 40. I also found a floating island. I wanted to check it out, so I decided to bridge up there. And eventually, when I did get up there, there wasn't really much. But I did manage to make a bucket. A wooden bucket. Yeah, those exist here. After heading back down, we then found a little bit of a crocodile friend of ours. Now, this wasn't a very friendly transaction here, because I needed its skin for armor. That was one of the first ever sets of armors you can get here, and I wanted it. So I built up a bit so he couldn't reach me, and I completely destroyed him. They were honestly no match for me. I say this as I have 4 hearts remaining and a really low amount of hunger. But that's besides the point. We got what we needed. Shortly afterwards, I also found a little bit of a cave. There was a little doll with a flower pot kind of looking thing. And the thing that the flower pot was holding was a donut. It was a very strange thing to find, but I just wanted it. I don't know why, I really just wanted it. And it helps out because now it gives us another food source that we can use. Not a very vast one, but it was still definitely something we can use instead of the glow shrooms. Because again, those glow shrooms really did save a bunch. I swear I'm not addicted. I created a stone pickaxe, but to my surprise, the stone pickaxe mines a lot slower than the wooden one. And then I remembered exactly why, because when making a stone pickaxe in this dimension, or any pickaxe from the overworld dimension, it basically is the equivalent or even less than a wooden pickaxe of this world. So I had to look through a bit of the recipes and notice that I needed this thing that was very similar to a mossy bone. Now there's two ways of getting these bones. Either one, I kill these zombie looking figures, or two, I got it from ores, and I was kind of aiming for the ore one. It didn't take that much mining. Honestly, it had the same scarcity as coal in the overworld, so it was pretty easy to find. After finding some, I then decided to upgrade my pickaxe, and it was so much faster. After finding that, I tried finding a cave, but we didn't have much luck, so we decided to head back up. When reaching the surface, I also found out that there were snails in this dimension. So I whacked it with my axe and decided to use it as another food source. We needed variety, and we needed variety fast, so, you know, we had to make some sacrifices, even though I kind of wanted to keep it as a pet. We also found out that all of the plants in this dimension weren't the safest. There are certain plants that actually damage you when stepping on them. At first, I thought I was being attacked by a mob, but when I turned around, all I saw were plants, so I had to keep that in mind. It looked a little different from the casual plants, so I just kept it in mind, you know, visual memory. But one of the most interesting things that I did end up finding was the living tree. Yup, a tree that's alive. Now, this thing is actually one of the boss fights, but we weren't going to be fighting one of these within these 100 days because this thing is super intense and super hard to fight, especially because it can grab its roots from the ground and trap you and cage you in like a bear trap. Not the best experience. And in all honesty, there were a bunch of roots that also were alive. So it's not only one creature, it's multiple creatures that are also trees. It's ridiculous. And upon entering there, they also shoot these little poison pellets. Luckily for us, we didn't actually get hit by any of them. I already knew that the tree was no good, so I was not going to be staying there for any longer than I needed to. I didn't want to fully awake the boss because that would have been a huge problem. So we decided to walk the other way. Days 41 to 45. We found another one of those floating islands. Right underneath it were some very thick roots, and that's exactly where we decided to base. I climbed up it and then decided to hollow out a little segment of it. Then I placed down a chest, created myself a furnace, and honestly was ready to make this place seem a little bit more roomy than it initially was. There was no real practical purpose of this, but I wanted to make a second floor. I guess you could say I wanted to utilize a little bit of the stone area at the top and make a little bit of a cliffside. But not only just a cliffside, but I also wanted to put glass there to make it seem kind of cool and also very appealing from the outside. Except I realized that we're not actually able to get sand in this dimension and I had no idea how to get glass. That was an issue, but it definitely wasn't going to stop me, so I decided to hollow out the area. Also put some finishing touches such as slabs and stairs on the top just to make it look a little bit better and remove some of the excess stuff and materials that just made the place look dumb. Days 46 to 50. After adding those finishing touches, I also wanted to make a little bit of a staircase downwards. I guess you could say it connects to the bottom of the root, or like the water in a sense. I'm not really sure what practical use that had either, besides just like a second exit slash entrance, just in case something does come by and completely just takes over. There's honestly a lot of creepy mobs in this, and I didn't want to be attacked by something I wouldn't be able to recover from, especially halfway through the challenge. I guess you could think of it as like a fire escape at schools. I wanted to gear up a lot more than I already have. I haven't made the armor set yet with the crocodile skin that we have because we needed a lot more than we currently have. I only really killed one of them, but I decided to go into the mines because I wanted to collect a bunch of resources. Eventually, after mining a bit, we finally got into this thing known as the caverns. A little pop-up came indicating that we were nearby one. So we broke into it and I decided to look around a bit. There were a couple stalactites here and there, but we didn't see anything too out of the ordinary. I wanted to build back up the way we came from, but then we got attacked by a demon bat. Apparently not only are they in the air, but they're also in caves? What? What kind of nonsense was that? It was honest, it didn't make no sense. After taking a decent amount of damage, I then went back into hiding, but eventually managed to kill it off. I then realized I should probably get myself some gear, and that should have been something I would have prioritized a lot sooner if I knew how difficult this mod pack was going to be. So we went back home and I looked into the recipe for making a shield. Luckily for us, we've already had the materials. It literally just required wood and some reeds, so it was super easy to make. I also cooked up some of the snail food that we had and a couple of the things that I was able to smelt up. I set out on an adventure to find some more of those crocodile things because again, I needed some armor. So that's exactly what I did. Days 51 to 60. We were looking around while all of a sudden we get attacked by these zombie-like creatures. Now these things look terrifying. They have glowing yellow eyes. A piece of their brain shows. It looks like someone jabbed their stomach out. and there's mushrooms growing on it. Like, I can't express how gruesome and terrifying these creatures actually are. As usual, I gave them the Iron Golem treatment. I built up a bit and decided to smack them up. Again, we've survived the Abyss, and I was not going to take chances like them two or one-shotting me halfway through the series. To my surprise, they actually dropped some of the bone things we needed for more bone tools, so that was kind of convenient. I tried doing the same Iron Golem tactic to the first crocodile that I found. It didn't go as planned because it was being a little repulsive, but eventually I did manage to kill it. It was very inefficient in terms of time, so I decided to use different tactics. And by that I mean, yeah, risk my life. Basically, instead of doing the Iron Golem tactic, I'm charging ahead on with my shield and wooden sword. But at the very end of it, we had a whole bunch of crocodile leather. After obtaining all of those materials, I then decide to head back and start making some of the armor pieces. And when I say some, I mean all. I made the entire set. After getting the armor set, I then found some more confidence in actually exploring the cave. So I went back down there in search for some lovely materials. And there were a bunch of stuff, such as the stuff we needed for torches and two materials that was kind of the equivalent of iron within this dimension, but I didn't actually know until much, much later. While mining, we also encountered this weird cube-looking thing. It was kind of like an armadillo. It kept trying to come at us. It had like a little roly-poly motion. But, you know, whatever, we managed to kill it off, so it wasn't that big of a deal. Day 61 to 65. I honestly wasn't just gonna stop there. I wanted to get the diamond equivalent in this dimension, and I was gonna strive to get exactly that. So we kept going further and further into the caverns. Unlike vanilla Minecraft caves, these caves don't exactly end very easily. They kind of continuously go on and on for very lengthy periods of times. And by that I mean the caverns are just huge. Kinda reminds me of the 1.17 update if you really think about it. But hey, you don't see me complaining. So we kept going down and we eventually reached the second layer of the underground systems. Now this one completely replaces the stone that was up above. I don't exactly know or remember what this block was, but it was a very interesting look. It kind of felt like I was walking on a bunch of jungle wood. It was a very strange texture. A material that we gathered known as octine was used to make not only a better pickaxe, but a better sword. We used, you know, a smelter to smelt it up and then crafted the two tools. Pretty straightforward advancements. Shortly afterwards, we then start, you know, continuously exploring, and we found some more of those zombie-like creatures, which we easily killed off. Oh, and a fun fact, the sword actually burns them, so that was a bit of a plus. It was an instant fire aspect sword. We got attacked by a bat again, but this time around, we had the flame sword, so it was a lot easier to manage. The specific ore that I was looking for was colored pink, and I actually didn't have any luck with it so far. I decided to mine into the cave a bit just to find a little bit of an area that had grass in it and a bunch of overgrown stuff. Not to mention, there was a crystal spawner right in the middle that I wanted to break, and I really tried getting myself in there. I felt like there might be some really special loot in there, and I kinda wanted to check it out, so I tried my very best. Despite the fact that the place was surrounded by these zombies, that wasn't even the worst part about it. It was the snails. The snails shot toxins at you. Like, what? Honestly, my health bar got super low, so I just decided to conceal myself in because I was not dealing with that whatsoever. I also tried going in a different way and a little bit of an above approach, but that also horribly failed and we decided to fall back. Day 66 to 75. In this duration of time, I then continued to search throughout the caverns. Eventually, we found one of these lakes. Next to the lake was also a large amount of the pink stuff that we needed. The material was known as valinite. This is the diamond equivalent of this world, and that's exactly the reason as to why I'm still going within these caves. If I wanted to beat any sort of boss, this was definitely the first step to it. And we were running out of a lot of time. I kept looking through the cavern and I found plenty of this stuff. After getting our fair share amount, we then decided to head back up. It was done. We were done with the caves. That is plenty of time that we spent down there, and I didn't want to be there any longer because we only saw a fraction of the mobs that actually spawned down there, and I didn't want to meet any more of its locals. Once we arrived at home, I then crafted up the armor set that we needed, and I also decided to craft a blue shield. The reason I didn't use the valinite is because I thought it might have a later on use if I do end up making a 200 days for this. Come on now, I'm not rich. But I do in fact use a lot more of the valinite on a sword, a pickaxe, and an axe. After making these, I then decide to go ahead and battle another one of these towers. I was gonna complete the tower and see what the loot was at the top because I honestly didn't know, I just knew that it was very useful. Layer by layer, there was a different mob and that's just how the thing functioned. It was pretty cool, but eventually at the very tippy top of it all, there were some lovely chests. It was a little bit anticlimactic because once we found out what the tower actually had in store for us, it was very useless stuff at this very moment because it was a bunch of starter stuff. There was also a huge variety of food, whether it was donuts, whether it was marshmallows. It did definitely give us some variety, but what I did find in there was some more valenite. Even though we didn't exactly need any more because we went through the mining trip, I still took it regardless. Like, who the heck doesn't want more valenite, right? I think it was about time that we went out of our way and fought the mobs. I don't think there was any more overpowered that we were gonna get besides this stuff, and I definitely didn't have the materials to make an enchantment table, and didn't know how to make one using the materials provided to me from this dimension. And just when I thought that I caught a break, guess what happened next? The ground underneath our feet started moving. Yeah, we were dealing with an earthquake. The tower, as I stood there, started crumbling before us. Honestly, I tried my very best to avoid any crumbling debris, but it was very challenging. I just simply decided to go to one of the sides of the walls and just chill there while the event was going on. I didn't know what to do because for all I knew, if one block hit me, I could have been a goner. Everything was shaking. The building, the structure, the land below us, and even my screen. I really didn't know what to do. I didn't even know we could get earthquakes in this mod pack. All I could do was stand there, helpless, without a plan. Day 76 to 85. Eventually, after the earthquake kinda calmed down, I then decided to look below. There was a bunch of the pathways missing, and a bunch of the blocks actually glitched, so it was very challenging to even get myself down. Eventually, I just decided to mine my way out. I quickly hurried back into my base and started storing a bunch of stuff and collecting a bunch of stuff I would have needed to kill off some of the bosses on the list that we had. So the first thing was I needed to find a nest, right? And the reason, because the king of all demon bats lived in a nest, and they're usually on top of the gigantic island, so I went exploring a bit. Eventually, I did in fact find my way around to one of those biomes, as you can see right here. Looking at the mother of all demon bats was terrifying. Not only did it seem like a challenging boss, but like, it was killing its own children. It was a terrifying sight to behold, and honestly, all I could do was sit there and watch. While it was distracted slaying its old children, I slowly decide to creep up onto its nest. I find out that there's actually babies that hatched pretty recently, and I decided to slay them. I don't know why that was a good idea, but they attacked me first, okay? So don't blame me. But shortly afterwards, the mother noticed, and they landed. They realized that we had killed off their kids, the literal things that the nest was supposed to be protecting, alongside the mother, and they were not happy about it. I decided to shoot as many arrows as I possibly could. I missed a couple of shots, but eventually I landed a couple, eventually burning them because I had a bunch of fire arrows stacked up. Despite our efforts, they then decide to use their main attack and shoot spikes at us, and then afterwards they pick us up to a really high height. I have already witnessed just how crazy these situations get, and all I needed to do was either one, land a water bucket, or two, land in the water because there were a bunch of lakes below us. We landed a water bucket and then quickly jumped into the lake. I just booked it. I honestly just booked it. We were not going to be able to kill that thing. That thing was near impossible to kill, okay? Like, the fact that before I can do any sort of damage, it just grabs me up into the air. I knew that I was not going to be landing every single water bucket, so I was not going to risk that. If the boss was maybe, just maybe, land-based, it would have been a much different situation, but that's just not the case. So we kind of had to move on to the next one. I had a little bit of an idea on exactly where I could locate one of these creatures, and we were looking for the tar beast. After a little bit of exploration, we eventually found the biome we were looking for. I'm not entirely sure what this biome is called, but I just ended up calling it the radiation zone because it looked like someone threw a nuke in there and it just completely blasted the entire area. And the mobs in there were not having it. Like, they were some of the most hard passive mobs, like the most passive aggressive mobs. Like, what is this? There were demon slimes, there were wraiths, you know, there was mud to slow us down. There was honestly a lot of issues with this biome. But instead of finding the tar beast, I ended up finding something worse than the tar beast. And it goes by the name of the Sludge Menace. When I was going through the world, I decided to kind of bridge around the place, right? Because that was the safest way to get across places. There's a bunch of mud, aka quicksand, and they make you slower. You know, it's very inefficient. But once I found out that one of the branches that were on the ground wasn't actually a branch and it was the Sludge Menace, things got a little bit rough. Let's just say this boss wasn't a boss that we should have reckoned with whatsoever. One of my first reactions to it was obviously trying to hit it a couple times, which I managed. A lot of stuff got in the way, so I decided to make a little bit of a cave. This allowed us direct access to the Sludge Menace and back from it, in case it was attacking us and we were getting super low. Despite all of the efforts I put in to actually harming the Sludge Menace, it ended up regenerating. It regenerates. It's a regenerating boss. It's like the Wither, but the regeneration effect is like times five. And that's as if the mob wasn't challenging the kill in the first place. Despite us having a full set of Valonite armor and a blue shield, which was probably the second best shield you could get in this mod pack, I was no match for it. We tried. We really did. I went right up to it. It decided to grab me. I had to shield the attacks that it did. But even shielding it didn't prevent it from hurting me. It led me to half a heart. After it let go of me, I put up the shield and I slowly take steps backwards. I couldn't take another attack from it. I couldn't risk all the time we've spent in this world. I was so low to a point where it was just ridiculous. After reaching a very safe zone, I decided to eat up and regenerate some of my health. I knew that this boss wasn't going down, especially due to the fact that my arrows just bounce right off of it. It has no effect. I'm sorry, but we were not going to be able to kill this thing, at least not within the first 100 days, and especially not with the gear that we have currently. As we did with the mother of all demon bats, we backed off. Days 86 to 90. In all honesty, I knew in the beginning that the Sludge Menace was going to be a tough boss, and I didn't know into what extent, but this was just a ridiculous curve. The difficulty curve on this was way too much for us, so we decided to continue our search for the Tar Beast, which is a much more to our level boss to kill. In this search of ours, I actually came across a little bit of a castle. Yeah, those exist. Apparently, they spawn in the wild. I decided to give it a look. I got attacked by another demon bat, but besides that, we ended up bridging up to there. I was definitely not gonna legitimately go through the rooms, especially when there's stuff like mini bosses in there. That was a risk factor I wasn't willing to take, but I definitely wanted to see what was at the tippy top of the castle. Also found out that there were a bunch of chests at the top of the castle next to spawners. I definitely would be interested in coming back here, maybe if I did a 200 days, and find out exactly what those chests entail, but for now, I just wanted to see what was at the top. At the very top of the castle, once we reached there, I honestly thought it was a bit of a portal. I wanted to go inside it to see where it would actually lead us, and if there was a mini pocket dimension in there. Think about how sick that would be. Nope. Instead, it was a force field and it bounced us back. This honestly could have led to our death because it was very dark and I couldn't see my surroundings, but luckily for us, we landed in the water. Fall from that height and we probably would have died. Days 91 to 95. Not too long afterwards, we eventually find the biome that the Tar Beast spawns in. We were looking around the tar pits and eventually we found one that the Tar Beast was in. Just by going near the place, the thing got a little aggressive and started attacking us. My biggest tactic at this point was to build up and create some sort of defense system. And that's kind of what I did, but it knocked me off a couple of times and it was a little bit problematic. But eventually, I ended up getting a little bit far away to a point where it didn't actually notice us, and I started bowing it down. We didn't have a lot of arrows, so I made sure that every shot counted, and eventually, we managed to kill the Tar Beast. I was so happy. The fact that we actually finished one of the goals. Why are these so challenging? I'd have to say, though, the Abyss has harder passive mobs, but this mod pack, hands down, has to have one of the most hardest bosses to face in all of mod packs. I'm just glad it's over with. Right afterwards, I then instantly took myself back home. Luckily, we had the cords and we just walked there. Luckily for us, we also got a bit of mud. The mud was the thing that slowed us down within that biome, but you'll soon see exactly why that's important. I put it into the furnace and then, you know, I just let that cook for a bit. I also start making parts for a little bit of something that I saved for the end of the video. So if you guys made it this far, this is for you guys. This is a compilation of a bunch of the stuff that I needed to craft in order to craft this thing. It was really hefty. Days 96 to 100. This was the final stretch. This is where we were going to end the 100 days of surviving in the Betweenlands. But there is something that I didn't want to meet, and that was groundbound. I wanted to lift off into the air and fly. That's what I wanted, and that's exactly what we were setting up right now. After crafting all of the parts, we then make this thing called the Drayton. After we get the Drayton, I then took myself up into a little bit of a ledge. We kind of bridged up, but it's whatever. I then soon also realized that we were lacking a bit of something, and that was something to pull the Drayton with. Luckily for us, I knew exactly what we were doing. I went back down, created a net, and I started collecting some dragonflies. Dragonflies spawn all over the place, so they were fairly easy to get. The reason we were catching dragonflies is because it was going to be the thing that would initially help us lift off. We then had full ownership of the dragonflies, and I got a couple because we were gonna need a couple. I slapped them onto the Drayton, and that was basically it. We were ready to lift off. And there we were, lifting off through the skies on a Drayton, with our fireflies. We were chilling. It was a little rainy at the time, I do have to admit, but it was still a relaxing ride nonetheless.